first lecture of our lecture series in the winter for semester. It's great actually to kick off with our friend Klaus here. You know, if you get into a dark room, that all of a sudden lights go on and off, that is because Klaus is putting his hands and body all over. So you have been changing the whole illumination of the lecture space, which is also amazing. Thank you, Klaus. For the ones that you don't know, Klaus Obermaier, he is a media artist, he's a composer, he's a choreographer, he's a very innovative mind that combines technology with arts in order to create different performances and different interactive designs. So he has been working with a lot of interesting people, individuals, but also he has been working with groups of artists, with big orchestras. He's one of a kind of artists combining different elements into a final piece. That is also why I am very, very glad that Klaus, since a few months back, he has joined the IAAC faculty family. He's co-directing the Master in Advanced Interaction together with Luis Rawada. It's our new master's program that we will be launching next October. So we're very glad to have him on board. And we're very glad that together with him, Luis, and a big team of experts at IAAC, but also invited experts, we will be working to deeper research and understand how interactive design can bring new relationship between human, machines, performances, and relations. So Klaus has been also teaching in many schools around the world, in Venice, in Roma, in Romania, I don't know which city. Klausenburg, that's good. And he has been showing his work different shows and exhibitions all over the world. So Klaus, thank you very much for being in the family. Thank you very much for being here today. And please help me welcome him on stage. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Areti. And thanks to the IAAC to invite me to that. And special also to Luis, who brought me to the IAAC. He's sitting here just in front. And I'm very happy to be here. And it's for me, that's an amazing experience here because it's an amazing place to be. You see so many creative people here. The teaching people which are doing all this stuff here are amazing, but also the students. So I'm quite, amazed to work with all of them. Okay, yeah. So let's stop with the honey, and let's go to some other stuff. I'm working with interactive technologies since 25 years, approximately. And I work with interactive technologies very often with the human body. So that means I like to involve dancers, actors, or the audience in an interactive situation. So this is one of my main focus. And what I'm also always interested very much, and that's of course something that is nice here too, is I'm very interested in the stage design. How is the setting? Very often it's not a design in the traditional way, but how do you do a clever setting that interaction works at all, or that what you show on stage is also working in a nice way that, yeah, it's becoming an artwork. You see just a little bit of selection of interactive works I did over the last 25 years. You see it started with a project which is called Immaterial. And this was a project with interactive laser. So it was my first interactive work. And at that time I was controlling the laser. I'm a musician also, so I was controlling the laser with my instrument. I play guitar. But we also had the laser as an instrument. You could touch the laser beams and play music with it. This was a work with the Kronos Quartet. I composed a piece for the Kronos Quartet and also did the stage design. This is in 1993, so quite long ago. So it was also very interactive. And At the end of this piece, it was one of the first pieces where I did also audience participation in a performance, which is a crucial thing, you know. And so we had the Kronos Quartet playing on stage, and at the end of the piece, they started to raise their bows and played in laser beams above their heads. And after that, the laser beams came down over the audience, over the heads of the audience, and so the people realized, hey, I can stand up, I can play the sounds as well. So they played in the sounds that the Kronos Quartet before was creating. Sometimes they do quite big projects. This was a project for 60,000 people, which were interactively involved in this environment. We distributed these strange yellow caps, and by taking them on and off, binary system, so they could control a lot of parameters, which of course we showed them on screens so that they got a feedback. So they could control the music in a huge bunch of people working together as DJs and even competing with each other. So we had two groups. As I said, I'm always interested how a stage design is. This was Oedipus Reloaded, a theater piece. And you see already, it's the guy is on a huge water surface, and because Oedipus doesn't know where he comes from, his parents are, it's a kind of metaphor for the human being nowadays, which we're still searching, who are we, you know, where we are going to. And so I invented just this huge water surface with 14 by 10 meters, and so Oedipus is literally always floating in the air. He never has a fixed safe ground below him. And it's also very nice because I had a big screen behind, and I mirrored the images down. So it was a super huge projection surface just by mirroring the images exactly on the water surface. I will talk about this later a little bit. It's Dancing House, you know, so it's a projection mapping on buildings. But of course, it's an interactive projection mapping. So you have to do something as the audience. Otherwise, nothing will happen. So it's, you are the co-creators. So you are the ones who have to go there and not just watch a nice image going on the building and or a nice video and 3D mapping. So you have to do something. These are some topics I want to talk about a little bit. You know, it's the integration of different media. It's one of my favorite things, and I will show you some works about this. So that the different media are not just side by side, the multimedia versus intermedia thing. Yeah? Intermedia, when the different media, whatever that is, a human being, a digital system, a light, whatever, is kind of creating something new, an entity that's becoming one. Interactive user installations and professional performance interaction is, of course, two different things, because in one hand, with performers, you know what they are doing when they're interacting with the digital system. You know beforehand, they learn the system. But in user installations, you have no clue what the user will do afterwards with it. So interactive projection mapping, like Dancing House, but I will show you some other works I did very early with very special projection mapping. Oh, I was too fast. User agency. I wanted to go back just to that. User agency, yeah. How can we give the it's again about interactivity, how can we give the user who is there something to do that makes meaning in a piece? Yeah? Okay, it's clear. When you have an interactive installation, you have to give agency to the user. And if you're lucky, there are a lot of users, and if you're lucky, your piece is done in a way that this is kind of pushing it. There's even a social interaction between the people who are the users. So they're not only interacting with your system, they're interacting between each other. And that's the social interaction, which I like very much when it happens. I talked before about this very old project, Imatrio. And we made it afterwards. I said it was controlled with instruments. But we also changed it into into a user installation. And this was an installation where you could touch the laser beams. You really literally could squeeze them, and they reacted with sounds also, like moaning and groaning. And if you squeeze them a lot, they even change the form. So they always become a new form out of it. Why I show that is because it's about comprehensibility. When you do an interactive installation, an interactive work, comprehensibility, so that you realize why is it happening, is very, very important. And that very often goes hand in hand with a good interface, or at least, this is a very good interface because you see what you're doing, you know? Of course, you get also the feedback from it. And the feedback is also very important. How do I get a feedback? What did I do? Because when you're a user in an interactive environment, you want to know what you did. If you somebody says, yeah, we're checking how many people are inside and that's why it has changed, you think, yeah, okay, but does it have something to do with me or directly? So it can be nice too. It's not that this is bad, but it's just nice when you get a direct feedback when you do something. So I go back now to the first topic, integration of different media, and also to the projection mapping. And this is a piece which I developed in 1998. We had a premiere in 1999, the first one, and then we made a longer piece out of it. And as you see, it's about how new technologies are invading the human body. Yeah? And you can read a little bit here. It deals with the manipulation and reformulation of the human body by means of biotech, genetic engineering, nanotechnology. Even changes his gender on stage. And as you can see already, this is projected on the body of the performer. This is not on the screen. Yeah? So that's what makes it very unique in a way, because there's no screen involved. Everything that happens in the show is projected onto the body of the performer. And it was very interesting when we, when Chris, the dancer, choreographer, he sent it out to some dance people and some organizers. And nobody wrote back, just there was one person. Thank you very much. You can switch it off. Thank you. Now you see, they are better with light than me. So only one person from, I think from France, was writing back and they said, Chris, are you crazy? You sent us a post-production video? Because they could not believe that we were just sending them this, you know, that projected onto the body, because they said, no, that's just not possible. Yeah? Anyway, I did another project like this. I will show you a video with this that you get a little bit more idea soon. And Vivisector is about, it uses a similar technology, but with four people. And you see, it's investigating a little bit the different speeds in people, nature versus technology, information society. It was very much also influenced by how computer games are changing how, the way how you behave. So it was an influence to the choreography as well. And it was very strange because in the first piece that you saw in Dave, there was, okay, projector projecting to the body of the dancer. In that piece, but I also used theater lights in certain scenes, yeah? Traditional lamps, you know, that you use in the theater. In that piece, there was nothing involved. One video projector, nothing else, yeah? So, let's have a look. So again, that's all projected just on the body of the performer. There's no screen there. And you see it's theater light in that piece, Dave, and so I'm mixing these two situations. And of course, that's projection mapping, yeah? But it's projection mapping in a very strange way because it's on moving bodies. So, which is a little bit harder to do than on a building, to tell the truth. So you have to find some ways how to do that, especially at that time when projectors were really bad. You know, this is nearly 20 years ago. Thank you.
Okay, the way I understand that they send the video back like that and not saying this is a post-production video, of course, and also.
And what I'm very much interested to is to use the projector, the video projector, as a very precise light source, which I did. We will see some scenes in that piece in BB sector now. You also see some close-ups, which you also saw in Dave before, which of course you will not see when you're in the audience. But it shows you a little bit what's happening. You know, it's kind of view behind the scenes. Huh? And that's what I mean when I'm more thinking not in a projection, still of course it's a projection, but I think more here like in light, and in a light that's a kind of, in that scene, the light is dancing and not the performers. So how to break the linearity of movement on stage, yeah. In that way it works, huh? So it's usually not really possible when you have human beings on stage, but this kind of projection invasion, of course, is a little bit giving the possibility. And everybody knows strobe light, right? But if you do this in a more clever way with the projector, you can have not only one strobe, you can have a lot of strobes. And so you can kind of create a very strange situation on stage, because it's, again, for me, that's light projection. So it's not a, don't see it as a video or whatever projection. Anyway, at the end we managed to play the piece quite a lot. We were touring it 10 years, but without sending out anything anymore. The rest was just, we did one show in Vienna and the rest was word of mouth. So we were quite lucky then. And it was quite funny with Vivi Sector when we showed it in the Ars Electronica Festival in Linz. At the end of the piece, I wanted to go out because it was our projector that we used, you know. It was anyway only one projector on stage, you know, but we said, hey, we want to go for a beer now, you know, we had the show. So let's see when the people are out, we can take our equipment, which means the projector, and go. And there were, I don't know, 10, 15, 20 people around the projector and filming and photographing the projector from all sides, you know, which was really funny because it was an ordinary projector, of course, you could buy everywhere. And there were also filming and photographing the space because they were looking for sensors. But this was not interactive. Huh? So this was interactive from the people, okay, from the dancers. Huh? So they were following exactly the video. So we, of course, we had to invent quite a lot of tricks for that. And now in apparition, it's again using body projection, but this is fully interactive. So here the performers can walk around more or less where they want. And it was developed together with the Ars Electronica Future Lab, as you can see here. And this has no real theme. The theme here is interactivity. So how can human beings interact with the digital system in a non-verbal, hopefully clever way? Yeah? So it has no other narrative in it. Yeah? And you see a little bit, these are basics that we used when we were working with it, you know, on the piece, on the development of the piece. And what you see here is maximum freedom for the performers because they can walk around. We do real-time masking, as you see here. We have a screen projection from behind, and we have projections on the body of the performers from front. And we use more or less only real-time generated visual content. And of course, because it's real-time generated visual content, which also is, as you see, is modeling and simulating real-world physics like springs, gravity, whatever. Yeah? So it's not just an extension of the performer, it becomes a kind of performance partner. And to make this happen, it's you have to give the digital system not that it's just reacting, but also its own life, its own behavior. So we have some scenes, not all scenes, where the digital system is predictable, but not fully. It has its own way to react what you do. And because there are a lot of scenes where you are improvising, interactivity only makes sense when you're improvising. Because if I know what the performer will do exactly, why should I do the big development of interactivity? It makes no sense. Yeah? So you give the system a freedom so that it's then communicating with you as the performer. And that's very important when you do something like this. What's for me very important also is I have no hierarchy of systems. So I'm not like that kind of person, you know, very often you go with the choreographer and the choreographer says, yeah, but you know, it's all about the body. Yeah. So no, it's all about everything that we're using here. It's about the digital system. It's about the light. It's about the stage. It's about the sound. It's about, so everything for me has the same level of attention. Of course, in the piece, sometimes more attention, but in the overall, especially in the development, of course, there's nothing is less important or more important than the other one. As you have seen, we premiered the piece in 2004, sorry. And that means there was no Kinect out then, you know, and you still could not do this with the Kinect because we're using a much too big space, you know, we're using a 9 meter deep space, wide space. The Kinect would not cover this space at all, so there's no way for doing this still with the Kinect. And of course, as I said, 13 years ago, there was no tool like this. Some scenes I can show you, of course, in that piece. So it's a lot of different scenes that I cannot show now. Projected on the body of the male performer, and now you will see the female performer entering the space as well. So it's just on the body, and yeah. It's like in Dave and Vivi's act before, so just that they can move now where they want. Yeah, so they don't need to check am I in the right place, and am I in the right moment, in the right place. Thank you.
Everybody likes touch screens, right? So we made a little big one there. We also were touring this piece very long, I think more than 10 years. The problem always is not only the technology gets old, but also the dancers. So, yeah, sometimes the trousers don't fit anymore, you know, and things like this. So, so it's not only the technology which is a problem, it's also the human factor. And this is the just if you're interested, that's the setup of Apparition. It's a side view. It's just a sketch, you know, where you see what's going on, and you see the blue stuff on the right here, and this is the box with the front projector, and there's also the infrared camera inside, and then of course we have the screen, we have a rear projection, two projectors in the back, and we have 18 infrared lights. And these infrared lights are covering the whole screen, so that means if I go in front of the screen, here in between, yeah, then here's the audience. Yeah? Then I will be a silhouette. Yeah? But with the silhouette, we can read out a lot of things. We can read out parameters like movement amount, position, proximity, body angle, speed of movement, acceleration, deceleration. It's a lot of things. Yeah? So you just can read out from, with good programmers, you can read it out from just this the silhouettes. And that's how it looks like in the projector box in front, because you see we have an infrared camera and we have a projector. One of the things that makes it a little bit easier, still have to calibrate the system a lot, but what makes it easier is that you align the two, yeah, so that they have the same field of view, kind of, yeah. So how to do that? You cannot put put the camera inside the projector, right? So Hirokazu Kato from the Osaka University, who was working with me on the project as well, he invented this mirror. It's an infrared mirror. Yeah? And so this is only reflecting infrared light to the infrared camera and leaves everything
undistorted, even if it's in that angle, you don't see any distortion of the video projection because it's going through the mirror. And so that's quite an amazing tool. I didn't even know about that, to tell the truth. So he was coming up with that tool and said, hey, you know, I got this. I was, wow. Nobody, also in the Ars Electronica Future Labs, ever saw an infrared mirror before. So it was quite interesting. Okay, just if you're interested in some things behind the scenes. Dancing House, I talked about it a little bit before. And there are so many projection mappings out there nowadays. It became a total hype, you know, in the last years. And especially in the commercial scene, you know, so for big companies, everybody is doing projection mapping. They want the biggest, the most fancy 5,000 effects, you know, with collapsing, going up again, and trains going through the windows, whatever, you know. So all kind of tricks. It's nice, you know, so it's just, I'm more interested in interactivity and getting the people not just watching it, like in a movie. I want them to do something. And so, of course, I showed it on a lot of places. And as you can see already, at the museum in Košice, in Slovakia. And nothing would happen if you're not moving. So it would just be, just look. Of course, there is an interactive zone in front of the projection tower, you know, and this zone is lit, so you can you realize where you have to go. You become kind of a performer, but of course more people can go inside and play together. Yeah, just that's the building, you know, so where it was projected onto it. And that's a totally different one. So it's a total different building. It was actually two surfaces, and we had two towers, so they could independently work with this. Yeah, and people are interacting, they didn't even know each other, they were just studying him. Yeah, you have to do this. So it's this social component, you know, which I talked before, which I like very much. When people start to interact, then you always have a bunch of people are just watching what you're doing, because you become a performer. And a lot of people forget about that they are doing something, that they're so immersed into doing, like this guy. He was absolutely going into it, you know, and forgetting about what's going on. Even if it's really cold out there, as you can see what they all have on, you know, all the clothes. Okay, just let's leave projection mapping for a moment. I want to talk about a piece I did with some students in Rome. I made students from a choreography, from the Accademia Nazionale di Danza di Roma. And they asked me if I teach them to choreograph with new technologies, and I was there for 1 month with some of my students then at that time, which are now my assistants and very good artists by themselves. And so it was not meant to be a project which we show afterwards somewhere. It was just meant to be a project that we do and for teaching. The funny thing was we showed it in the small theater there at the end, as you usually do in the academy. And then people were emailing me, Klaus, you have a new show, can we have it? And I was like, oh my God, you know, this was not meant to be in a professional context, you know. You see, we worked a lot with things like camera perspective versus perspective of the audience view and perspective of the director, and how to use this in a clever way was one of the things. And funny enough, because we were asked for that, so we version of it, and we opened a lot of festivals, so very big festivals like the Ruhr Lights Festival. It was part of the European Cultural Capital in Duisburg, and with a piece which I did not even consider that it will go that high, but I had really good students to tell it, so it was about that. So I said, we also did it outdoors. You saw before, it was already a building, you know, in Duisburg, where we mapped it also, to tell the truth. So, but here it's, we just used this big wall here, which this was the biggest one we did outdoors so far. It's a museum in Gallarate in Italy, near Milano. And they have this huge outdoor wall here. And we use this as our backdrop. And this little part is from Transcranial, another piece I did. You can see again, I'm interested in how to use light. And it's again, here the light is dancing more than the performer even, or let's say together. Yeah? But again, projectors as light sources, which I can control very precisely. That's now the concept of this piece I was talking about. I was just putting these two together because I used a similar technique for both of them, just that I have here two performers on stage. And it's just two side projectors, you know, which are coming from right and left to the stage. And one is going, of course, to the back of the dancers. This is now on this big wall that you saw before, the outdoor wall in of the Gallarate Museum. And what I like very much also is always to work with very special things. Like she has really black a black body on, right? Yeah? And that's why you can see through. Hitting the wrong button. Give me a second so that I can run it again and go to the right place. It was a little bit too fast. So if I find a mouse, so we'll find probably the right place. Let's go a little bit forward here. Ah, okay, here we are. So, too close. So you can see, I can see through her body, and that's why it's getting these very interesting structures when we do this video feedback here in real time, you know? So we could not do that if she has another clothes on. So, working with clothes also is very, very interesting because you can kind of cut off body parts. So here they also are controlling everything by themselves, so they can play around with it. Of course, we know a lot of things what to do, but they are quite free with it, and the system is very reactive to what they are doing. And again, it was a big play with the perspective of the camera, of the view of the camera, and you will see it in the next scene even stronger. Yeah, it's a good perspective, right? Thank you. Quite simple effect. It's kind of video feedback what we're doing here, but very reactive to what the people are doing. Yeah. And but it's quite simple to make here. It's more the more important thing is here how it is set up. Again, I'm using this black cover, so she can really just use parts of her body which are feedback in the video. Okay, so by the way, these were huge projections as you saw before, right? So really big, never done with the 10 euro camera, you know, it's the PS3 cam, which has a resolution of 640 by 480, but it has quite a good quality. As you saw, we did this, we didn't tell, of course, the organizers that we use a 10 euro cam, but so you not always need the most sophisticated equipment, yeah? I just brought these cameras for the testing with them, you know, and then, wow, it was working really good. We made it bigger, bigger, bigger. Oh, still good. Yeah, so it was quite amazing, you know. So I say this because it's very important that you just try and not think, yeah, but I don't have the equipment, so I cannot do it. No, you have it for sure. Somehow you will have it. Here it's a little bit different. Zakirabrenov is really using some hardcore equipment. It's again a collaboration with the Ars Electronica Future Lab. We did it for the Bruckner Fest, where it was the premiere there in 2006. And other than in the other pieces, I was, in Apparition, for instance, I was surrounding the performer with a kind of digital environment. Here, the performer, you see it here, this is how it looks like in real. This is everything that you will see on the screen here is, let me just point the right thing, is created by her. So every object that you see then in the video, which I will show you, is done by her before. And then she's even going into that virtual space. But what's very important is this is stereoscopic projections. You see a space, yeah? Just I cannot show this to you because we are just here in the 2D world on this thing. But because we have this stereoscopic projections, everybody has to wear polarized glasses, right? Here it's from that, we also did it outdoors. It was broadcasted outdoors at the premiere. And so young and old people had to use polarized glasses. And this is actually the original photo from the expensive seats in the premiere in Linz, Austria. So it was really fancy glasses. I'm not sure if this was the more attractive thing than the show. And imagine, there was a big hype about all this 3D movies, starting more or less with Avatar, right? This was premiered 3 years before Avatar. So, and everything that you see here is done live on stage, not in a studio before, and then just showing it with the glasses. Everything is done by the dancer on stage, and she's creating it, and the computer system is interacting with her, letting her create this and interact with her. You see, they have a lot of stereo cameras around the stage, and of course, we need a sophisticated system to run the whole thing, because this was as 2006, you know, it's quite some time ago, and so now you could probably skip half of the equipment easily, but we're still touring it, and so we're still using the original equipment, to tell the truth. So we work, we're I'm always very nervous when we go somewhere because it's equipment that's 10 years, 11 years, 12 years old. Can you imagine? This is really okay. So, but never change a winning team, you know. So I always cross my fingers when we go somewhere. Anyway, the future lab always have to test it before when we go. And but just to tell that, I used a lot of things here. I don't know if you know Le Sacre de Printemps of Igor Stravinsky. It's a very iconic piece in the classical music and in ballet. And I, of course, did my own story. It's much more about a human being who's creating all these fancy digital worlds than more or less getting absorbed by herself with this digital environments. And the show starts with the glagolitsa, the oldest known Slavic alphabet. She's drawing that with her hands on the stage, on all parts of the stage, all four walls. It's what this red lines, but she already changed it here by her movement. So they're becoming then something else. And it finishes with the newest language, the hexadecimal code. And everybody will say immediately, yeah, yeah, matrix, you know, right? So the big difference here is, it's actually a quote of matrix, which I did here. But the big difference is what you see here is the code that is running to make himself visible. You understand? So you're watching the computer computing himself. Yeah. So the surface is the code, but there has to run a code to make the surface. Yeah? So it's quite an interesting metaphor when you go already into the machine. That's the end scene, the very final scene, and you're more or less landed already in the computer and watch the computer computing. You saw it's a big orchestra on stage with 110 people usually. Yeah? So big mess, you know. And but the orchestra is also influencing that virtual environment. So I chose 8 instruments and equipped them with microphones. And it's, for instance, in one scene, another scene, something else, it's changing here the floor. And I told before, we did it also at the premiere, we did it outdoors. We had about 8,000 people with all equipped, of course. We distributed 3D glasses, stereoscopic glasses. And they watched it in the Danube Park there outdoors. So that's how it looks like when it's a bright light. Very bad. Yeah, that's where she was drawing the glagolitsa. The projector has a very strange red, as I noticed. I can imagine that was a scene where I literally see her touching your nose, so you don't see a flat surface, you see space. And that's, of course, all happening live. You know, there's no, this is not a video running. So she's manipulating her body together with the system. And you can see her and you can see the system. Or like this, you know, so she's just moving on the floor and we multiplied her, of course. It's a pity that you cannot see it in this three-dimensional space, which is, of course, one of the most important things. Thank you. As you can imagine, we had a very small stage for the dancer, and this was very good because this restriction was super good for creativity. We had to find very special choreography. But in the virtual space, we had a huge space because I used very wide-angle cameras. So this small space looked in the virtual world like a huge space with a huge depth. Just two more shows I show you and then I finish. Ego is a project I did with my two assistants, Stefano D'Alessio and Martina Menegon, which will also work with Luis and me a little bit in the MAI, in the Master of Advanced Interactivity. And I show you just a video that to get a little bit of idea what's going on. You see, it's skeleton tracking with the Kinect, right? So just that the system has a little bit its own life. The more you move, the more it freaks out, so it doesn't follow you anymore. And the nice thing with this installation is, because it's only using white stripes, we can even do it when it's not very dark. So we could do it in a white, bright surrounding. And we showed it one time in a theater foyer in Germany, and it was really funny. The people were coming out in the pause just to drink a glass of champagne or coffee, and by accident they were caught by the system, you know. And for a lot of them, it was very interesting to see what is happening to them. How do you react to this? Because after a few seconds, you realize, is that me? Wow, this can be embarrassing, right? So, or it can be funny, or it can be, it has very strange effect on yourself. And it depends on the person who's using it. You saw the girls were having fun, you know, other persons. When we did this in a theater foyer, it was really devastating, like, oh my God, you know, a lot of them were frightened, other ones went in. And it was nice to see how they interacted again with each other, you know. So we had situations where people just stole it from the other, because it's only over two, but you can go in five people or more, but then you steal it when you go in front of the other one. So you steal the figure from the other one. So, and in that moment, it becomes a very social environment. We also did it outdoors, as you can see, because you can nearly project it on any wall. It was just quite a dark brick wall, by the way. So. And it worked pretty well. So let's go to the very last piece that I want to show you, because I was talking about the project that I did with the Kronos Quartet, you know, the clone sound very quickly. And when I said that the lasers are coming down over the head of the audience, so I was always interested in not only interactive installations, but also how can people interact in a performance, which is very tricky, because professional performer just gets bored when he is working with amateurs. And the other way around, maybe I say, oh, you're sitting in the first row, please can you come up, please can you come up, you have to do something, you know, you're, my God, why did I sit in the first row, you know, it's just, I don't want to be embarrassed and now I have to do something, you know, which I don't like at all. And so it's about a lot of things, but it's also about the narrative that you have to create. You have to create a very special new way of narrative, a flexible one. So I don't want to go too deep into that. But what we were using, we used a lot of different, it was part, by the way, of a three-year research project, and that I did together with the Future Lab in Linz again. And So we researched a lot of things, how can we involve the audience in performance situations. I will only show you one little part of it because we did a lot of different ways of interacting. One was just using the smartphones, which is quite obvious, of course. And so you go there and you realize, okay, you get a link where you can go to and you can send messages, 40 characters, you know. And you can send them and they come to the screen, even with the sound, and you see them, they're immediately there. So you get immediately a feedback, hey, that's what I wrote. Huh? But after a few seconds, they turn into an anagram. And you know what anagram is doing, it's changing the letters. And very funny things come up, you know, very embarrassing sometimes. You know? So it's starting to become more than just your message. And also, as you can read here, after a while, the people started to, oh, I saw this nice girl with the red hair before, you know, what's your name? And, you know, so they started to can create of interaction beyond what we thought, you know. I mean, we thought about that, we'll hopefully do it, but you never know what they're doing, yeah? So this was a very interesting point there, too. So again, we created a kind of social environment for the people. And you know, this is all written, all text that they did, which after a while, first you saw them big, so you saw it was your text, but after going through the anagrams, it was just going to the back, and you kind of created the whole stage. The people didn't know when they did this, they just sent messages. So they were not aware that they're creating a stage, yeah? Where the performer then comes in and is interacting with. Yeah? But imagine just, think about, not the performer at the moment, think about a situation like this. You have it in a theater foyer again. You have it on an airport in the waiting hall. Yeah? And you have a huge screen. The people read somewhere a link. Then they get a web app. It's just a web app, you know, so you don't have to install anything. And then just can write something. Ah, fucking airplane is late again, you know. So you can really express your emotions or whatever, or you just, yeah. Or you whatever you like, and people start to fill the screen, you know, and when it's full, things drop down, go away again, you can refill it with new content, or this can be in any public space. I think it's an amazing way of waiting for something, yeah, because you really can get into it, because you can write everything, you can just make fun with letters, whatever. Yeah? Anyway, just to say, just want to play this last video and then that's it. Yeah, that's how it happens. That's how it looks like when I send it. You see the letters changing. It's just a very quick beginning. Somebody knows what Dada is? Yeah, it's 101 years ago it was founded. And this is the most famous Dada poem from Kutschwitters. It's called the Ursonate, which I used the text for it, which is a very strange text, abstract.
The verdict.
Yeah, thank you very much for your attention. Thanks a lot.
So thank you so much, Klaus, for your lecture. The videos are mesmerizing, and I really can't wait to be able to interact with something. So I'm very excited to see what the advanced interaction students will come up with. Excellent. I'd like to ask if anyone might have any questions for Klaus. And if you do, if you can just raise your hand. Yeah, it's coming. Yeah.
Hello. Amazing work, really incredible. And Mathilde said very mesmerizing. But I couldn't help wonder, but I was thinking about architecture and how this is connected. And usually in architecture, in contemporary architecture, the process starts with a concept and we end with the material. And usually the material is something that is decided on the phone with a client in a 5-minute conversation. There are some architects who do it the opposite way. They start with a material, they end with a concept, but they're somewhat rarer. In your case, the material is always light. And so it comes down to the manipulation of light. And I was wondering what comes first. Who is the protagonist often in your process, the concept or the materialization or the manipulation of the material?
Yeah, there is really no one answer, to tell the truth, because it really depends on the project. So it's very different. So sometimes my ideas come just from a movement. Yeah? Sometimes they come from the situation, from the space. Yeah? And sometimes they just come from a sound. So, or from the light idea, or just from the setup idea very often. You know the idea with, you saw this where I was using the lights on the bodies from right and left, where you literally saw that the dancer jumping 10, 20 centimeters, but she was not, you know. This was, I just had the idea about really the setup before even doing anything with the performers. And I just hooked up my 3D program, created two projectors and a screen in the back and another projector for the screen, and tried it out, and I was, wow, it's working like I thought. Yeah? And then I was going there with the performers, and then we did the choreography. But it could be the other way around as well. You know? So it's very, I have no rules for that. That's very interesting. But you know, when you say this with the architects, it's quite funny, because you saw Ego, the one with the outlines, yeah? And I was asked already by two architects, architect bureaus, offices, who approached me if they can have it, both of them, for an hotel, yeah, in different countries, you know? We would like to have this in the foyer of the hotel, which we still did not build, you know? So we are building it, which I liked, because they were asking before to build it. So in that way, if it works out, you know, this could be interesting that we even talk about what material is needed there. You know, how could be the space, you know, that you can do some interaction. I think this could be a very interesting process in the future, that to implement this already and not only think, where can we hang a picture afterwards, you know, or something like this. So that you think more like this. And that's not only for the light projections. That's also if you have interactive objects, you know, and especially Louis, for instance, he's very good in all kinds of interactions, also with objects, with three variables and all that stuff. So that's why we do also this together. We try to combine our strengths, you know, and imagine if you already think when you build the foyer, the size of it, how big is it, or how is it ordered, you know, how is it set up?
and implement something interactive. I think this would be amazing, you know. So this would give a lot of possibilities in the future. That's also what we try then to teach so, in this master. Thanks for the question. It was really interesting. Ah, we have a second.
Hi. I wanted to ask you why you mentioned at one point that technology from like 10 years ago or something, why are you still using that technology if nowadays we have so many, you know, advanced, I don't know, equipment, et cetera?
Yeah, the problem is just, first of all, it's very hardcore programming what we did. It was in Le Sacre de Printemps. In this dance piece with the stereoscopic images when I said it, I think so, I was in that piece. And, you know, it was, it's now 12 years ago that we started the development, you know, that means the computers are 12 years old. The problem was at that time, when we did pieces like this, the same was true for Apparition, for instance, we really had to go that the machine is squeezing out the very, very last drop of power from that machine. So, because at that time, this was nearly impossible to do what we did. We even had to find tricks, you know, to do that, you know. And if you put, that means also it was very much programmed in C++, OpenGL and other things, you know, to these machines. If you would change the machines now, you would have to reprogram it. And that is quite a hardcore stuff because you cannot only reprogram it, you have to retry it, yeah? That means money. So for us, it's simpler to have this working thing, which is going well, you know. But of course, if there would be a budget for that, it would be just super cool. We just would probably go with two laptops now, you know, so and then and do the whole thing. And I would love it, you know. Anyway, I don't have to carry it, you know, so it's okay. But that's the reason, you know. If we would have programmed it more hardware independent, then it would be an easy task, you know. But this would probably change the frame rate, change the, I don't know, so many parameters, it would be a hassle. Wow. So it's a very, very simple reason, you know, very, very money technique, you know, reason.
Hello. it's a very non-technical question at that point. As you are also credited quite often as a choreographer, mm-hmm. I was wondering, how do you work on the choreographies? What's your approach to that?
That's quite an interesting thing. First of all, it depends very much on the performer I choose, yeah, and because that's changing what I can do. So I cannot put on a performer who cannot do something. I cannot say, let's take again Le Sacre de Printemps. Julia is not able to jump like hell. She's not good in this super physical thing. So I had to deal with that. At the other hand, I wanted to have her because she has a background in ballet. So she was a prima donna in opera houses, you know, and then went into the free market. And but she also was doing performances then with contemporary shows, you know. So this was interesting for me, and I saw in other shows, and then we met each other, and I was said, yeah, I want to do something if I have an idea, and so, and then this was coming up, and I thought about her. So, of course, there must always come an input from the performer as well. Yeah? So today you're not choreographing and standing there and saying, you do this, you do that, which is the typical thing in ballet. Yeah? But ballet is a fixed language, you know, so here you have to come up with a lot of ideas from the performer, but especially for me also from the body of the performer to realize the restrictions, but also to push her. You know, so I don't want that we just do what she can. I also want to always challenge her, you know. Yeah, but that's hard for me. Yeah, you understand? You have to do something that's hard, otherwise we just feel you like going on the stage like that. I want to see the tension, you know. So it has this, it's a very strange process. But what is interesting for me is because I'm working with the programmers and I'm also working with the dancers and I'm working on the music, if it's my music, of course, not in Le Sacre de Printemps. So I can do a lot of things. I think about the stage. I think about which cameras we choose, you know. So so I have a big knowledge about all these things when once I go there. So I was able to choreograph with Julia just without any technology, because we didn't have the technology then. Yeah? if I would do this with a choreographer from outside, how to explain what's happening? Yeah? I know what will explain because I'm going next week to the programmers, you know, and I know how it will look in 2 months. Yeah? Because we work on 1 year with a piece like this, you know, it's a development over 1 year. And so I realize a lot from working with the performer and then going to the programmers, and then with the programmers going back to the performer. So, but we, 90%, we just choreographed without any technology, just a room, space, dance floor, and of course the size of the stage was determined, you know. And that's very interesting. But you know, dancers start to complain immediately. When I said we just have four and a half meters, oh my God, it's too small, I cannot do anything. Yeah. And I always say, hey, restriction is what makes art. Yeah. Because when you have this restriction, you have to think about very specific stuff. You know, so what can I do here which just makes the piece special? You cannot run from here to there. So what can we do that it's still interesting? Yeah. You have to find even better ideas. So that's what I like very much, this challenge, you know. But it sounds funny because I'm not a trained dancer, you know, so which today quite some choreographers, Jan Fabre, for instance, are never were dancers, you know. So, but very often I just stand at home in front of the mirror and try to make movements and try to find out stuff, you know, what can I do, you know. And then I go to the performers and Work it out with them, you know, and so, yeah, because I always liked the movement very much. So that's when I started first time to work with dancers was now about 24 years ago, was a dancer from the Nederlands Dans Theater, and I immediately had the feeling, wow, I want to do that, you know, in the future more. So it was an interesting point. Hope I answered the question. Some. Okay. We can talk afterwards.
I have a question.
Oh.
You showed some astonishing work with projection mapping, and I'm wondering, with the hype on augmented reality, do you see at some point augmented reality replacing what you do with projectors in terms of like overlaying digital content on physical?
I mean, one of the things that I'm not so keen of with augmented reality and also virtual reality with headsets, you know, so is it's so enclosed into yourself. So I have no idea what the other one is seeing, you know. So what I liked very much, I said this very often, is the social interaction, you know. So if I interact, let's say, with the building, you know, the other people are seeing what I'm doing and they see what the building is happening. Yeah. If I just have my personal view, this is very difficult to create this social interaction. But that doesn't mean that I will get, maybe when I have an idea, interested in that, you know. So it's just I didn't have it yet. You also saw that in none of the pieces somebody had any sensor on, right? Because I like very much when I go in an interactive installation, I just can go there. Wow, and it's happening, yeah? So if I go somewhere and then they say, yeah, but we have to equip you, and okay, a cable here, and it's already for me. It's just for me, you know? It's a little bit killing this sensation also of being there. But that's just my trip, you know? So it's nothing that I would put onto other people or on the students, for instance, you know? Because if they like to go for that, they should. And they have to. Probably I will learn a lot by that. So, and but this is just my thing. I like this freedom also on the dancers, you know, they have nothing on, they can roll on the floor because they are not killing a remote something, you know. But of course, if I would have an idea, I would go for it. And maybe, I mean, I was recently on a festival where they had quite a lot of headsets. And which is really nice because you can walk in space, you know, and it's tracking your space very nicely, which the others are doing now as well, but they were the first ones. And so there could be a little bit more of also social interaction, because you can recognize another people as well in the virtual world. Still, it's a little bit restrictive with the cable hanging around, you know, and but yeah. Let's see what's coming up. It's still not my main thing, because I like very much also this body interaction. I like the sweating people. I like this, you understand, it's this kind of thing. But yeah, my trip.
Amazing work.
And I'm just curious of what's your background? How did you end up in doing this?
Yeah, sometimes I ask myself that. And I studied classical music, and I studied a little bit visual arts and graphic design before, you know. So I always wanted to become a painter when I was young. There was no computer then, so I could not use the computer for doing my arts, you know. So I was still thinking in the whole analog way. I studied classical guitar. I was even touring as a classical guitarist, you know. So I did records and things like this, and I performed with the Ensemble Moderne, if somebody knows that. And yeah, so this was my origin. But I also played, of course, I had always my bands. That means electric guitar. That means technology, some stuff, you know. And then I was going into some nice virtual preamplifiers and things like this, you know. So I went more into that. And of course, then when the first Atari was coming up, I immediately grabbed the Atari, but using it for the MIDI music at that time, you know. There was nothing else that you could do with it. Super nice big screen like this, you know, in black and white. And then I was able to get hands on the first Mac, because they became available and payable. Still, they were quite expensive. And immediately I always was sometimes video, but all analog way. In that moment, I realized, even if it was small videos that you could do at that moment, I can do this now with the computer by myself. And I'm one of these strange people who always wants to do it by themselves, you know. So sometimes I cannot, which I really hate. I want to dance, but I can't. So I would like to do everything by myself if I could, you know, because I'm totally curious in all these things. I love them, you know. I love to know. So I could never do this. I'm the director of all these pieces. I could never stand there and say, okay, build it up, and I come back when it's finished, and then I work a little bit with the dance, and then I go, okay. I sit there, hanging there on the stage, mounting the camera, because I know I want the camera that precise. So, of course, all the technicians in the halls always think, oh, you're another technician, you know. They'll never respect me as a director. But I love to do that, you know. I love to know all these little things, and because this is giving me ideas for my next project. If I know how it's working, I can get new ideas. If I just have to wait that somebody's telling me how is this working, I cannot get the ideas by the possibilities what the technology or the setup or the light or whatever is giving to me. That's what I really love. So, but this was kind of the way, you know, floating then into the Mac, and then it was kind of, I think half a year after I had the Mac, I already did the first thing. Yeah, I bought the Mac in 1990. And 1991, I did the Immaterial, the first interactive piece with the lasers and things. So, yeah, you have to meet the right people to tell the truth.
Okay, so we'll have just one more question. The best question. So, Klaus, when are you going to bring one of your performances or installations to Barcelona? We want to be part of it.
If somebody is inviting me, I bring it immediately, you know. So, it's just a question of invitation and money. And I think the last piece here, I showed this quite a while ago, you know. So I did two shows here in Barcelona. One was Apparition, by the way, you know, so in the Macates Rose, but quite some years ago. And the other one was just a small project I did with another string quartet, the Balanescu Quartet. I don't know if you know it, you know. It's an English string quartet, but with the origin guy from Romania. And we did a project where I just did a little bit of mapping and a little bit of manipulating old videos, because it was about a singer of the last two centuries now. No, last century in Romania project that we did. We did it some in the Greek theater, is it called like this, on the Manchuk? Yeah. Okay, yeah. But it's also quite some years ago now. So yeah, nobody wants me. That's the problem, you know. So.
So thank you very much, Klaus. It would be great if everyone could join me in thanking with another round of applause.